Apple and I are here to talk to you about flea and tick medications and heartworm medications. Before I get into that, I should explain about the eye patch. I'm really okay. I had a simple little ophthalmological procedure done day before yesterday, and everything's great, but it is pretty ugly, so I thought I'd spare you that. However, as a result, this video will be rated R. Did you find that funny? You didn't laugh. I should also tell you that I am not a veterinarian, and I want to make that very clear from the beginning that the information I'll be giving you is simply sharing the experiences that I've had and explaining what I do. And I'm not necessarily advocating that everyone should do the same as what I do. So quite a few people have asked me about these medications. And the very first thing you have to do if you're thinking about flea and tick medications is how to actually detect the fleas and ticks to make sure that that is what you need to treat. Detecting fleas is really not all that difficult. What you're seeing here is a flea comb, and it's a very fine tooth comb. When you want to use the flea comb to find and, if they are present, remove fleas, all you have to do is to run the flea comb at about a 45 degree angle to the dog's skin, right through the coat. And what will happen is if there are any fleas present, they will get caught between the tines of the comb and they will be trapped there. I usually keep a damp paper towel next to me. So if I do find a flea, I kind of fold it into the damp paper towel and that will paralyze it for long enough until I'm done. And at that point, I could just throw the whole thing outside so that they will be gone from my house. Finding ticks is maybe a little bit more difficult. They should be removed very carefully, very slowly with tweezers so that the head and all comes out at once. I find it easiest to just run my fingers through the dog's coat like this, and either you will see the tick, which is a lot easier when you have a light-colored dog, or you'll feel a little bump, which you will then investigate more closely by parting the coat and looking. If we do find fleas or ticks, our first step is to treat the environment. Treating the environment can be a little bit tricky because there are a lot of chemical sprays that are sold which may or may not say that they're safe for dogs. Some of them are, some of them are not. There are plenty of sprays that are made from natural ingredients, things like peppermint oils, that sort of thing, which are safe for dogs. Or you could actually consult a professional exterminator and talk to them about using some sort of spray that would be safe for your dogs. One of the things that will attract fleas and ticks would be a sandy soil and long grasses. So if you have a grass lawn, make sure it's cut nice and closely. If you have ornamental grasses or bamboo or anything like that, you'll want to cut them down to the point where they don't host the little pests that you want to get rid of. We always hope that by treating the environment and removing the pests from the dogs, that we would get rid of the problem. If it doesn't get rid of the problem, then the next step is to take some medical steps. I would never, ever use anything like a flea collar or any of those topical treatments, those little drops that you put on the back of the dog's neck. I certainly would never think of using those or any other medications on young puppies. I've personally seen cases of young puppies that were harmed by exposure to topical treatments at too young an age. There are medications that are available, tablets that you can give your dog, and they're generally administered as a once-a-month treatment. If we find that the steps we've taken haven't gotten rid of our fleas and ticks, we will give one single dose to each of our dogs of one of those products. I don't want to mention any brand names, so you don't think I'm favoring one over the other, but you'll probably see the big ones advertised all the time, and you'll see them in pet shops and online and so on. They are considered generally safe, but in a small percentage of cases, there have been documented cases of adverse effects. The most common adverse effect is vomiting. If your dog vomits after being given a dose of one of those treatments, I personally would just take that as a sign that the dog's body is rejecting it and not consider using that on that dog again. Other possible side effects are things like itchy skin, lethargy, diarrhea. And that's the list of side effects that you will see when you look at the documentation that comes with the drugs. But there are a small percentage of cases where dogs have suffered seizures and occasionally death after being administered those drugs. There's no causal relationship that has been established, but I still think that it's just something I don't want to take a chance with. We found that when we use the one single dose, it gets rid of the pests that are on the dogs, and as long as we've done our job to treat the environment and take the pests off the dogs that are already there, that generally does the trick. The other thing that we wanted to talk to you about and that I get a lot of questions about is heartworm medication. Heartworm medication, again, is generally administered on a once-a-month basis. But I've found that in at least where I live, it's not really something that I want to do. Again, there are some documented cases, small percentage, but enough to worry about, especially when you have multiple dogs. You know, like if I have five dogs in my house, I'm going to have five times the chance of having a problem that you will if you have only one dog. So I guess Apple got tired of helping us out here. So we looked very carefully about the need for treating for heartworm. Heartworm medication works by killing the larvae of the heartworms once they've entered the dog by being bitten by a mosquito. And that larvae has to exist and mature in the mosquito before it gets into your dog. If, where you live, the temperatures are not warm enough on a sustained 24-hour basis so that the larvae can grow inside the mosquito, then they will never be mature enough to be implanted in your dog when the dog is bitten by the mosquito. What you're looking at right now is a map of the United States. I'm sorry I don't have a map of Europe or Australia or any of the other places where I know people are watching our videos, but I'm sure you could Google it and find one for yourself. But if you look at this map, right here in New York, on the coastal area, is where I live, and you'll see that it's, according to the legend of the map, it is an area where the incidence of heartworm is less than 0.5%. So the chance of our dogs being infected by our heartworm-laden mosquito is rather small. In addition, our dogs spend very little time on a long-term basis outside. They go out through our doggy door to do what they have to do in the yard, and they generally come right back in again. They don't lounge around outside. So there's a very small window of opportunity for a mosquito to bite the dog. So if we combine all those factors, rather than risk the, again, possible, even though it's a small percentage, adverse side effects, which can be serious, we choose not to treat our dogs for heartworm. And by the way, we do not treat our dogs for heartworm, and we have not had a case. We spoke to a local veterinarian and asked her if she does see cases in this area of heartworm, and she said yes, but only in the dogs that have come from the southern areas of the country. If I lived in Florida or Georgia or Texas, I probably would treat my dogs. However, the treatment does not have to be year-round. You can do an annual blood test in the beginning of the warm season. In this area of the country, that would be around May, early June. And as long as the blood test comes out negative, then the dog can be treated up until, I suppose, in our area, maybe November, possibly beginning of December. So I hope that helps you a little bit. If you have any questions, feel free to leave a comment and I'll get back to you. Please keep in mind, I'm not giving veterinary advice. This is just sharing my own experience with you, which has worked out well for us. So, Apple, come here, Apple. Come on. She's a little shy. Apple, come up. There we go. So, on behalf of Apple and the rest of our crew, hope your dogs are healthy and happy, and we'll see you again soon.